I will talk briefly about other kind of things that we can see on the site, inside the churches, or about things that we cannot see in the churches, because some of them were not meant to be seen, at least largely, or also because they are kept under the authority of the church, for some of them still in use and not so easy to access. My intention is to see how we can try to see and to insert these objects in the different sequences of the history of the site. Of course, we could dream that these objects can tell us something about the dating of the monuments, but of course it doesn't function at all. But anyway, they give another picture to complement the history of the site. With the term of objects, I mean a very different kind of things, like sculptures, bas-reliefs, and wall paintings, first of all, which have a structural relationship with the monuments, and that could be closely linked to their dating, but also mobile objects, like manuscripts. We worked about on around 200 manuscripts kept there. Some of them also contain historical texts, but most of the time talking about intonation or inventory of books, but they don't say anything about the historical architecture. We have also wooden altars. Marie-Laure already showed some of them, or icons and other things used in the for the liturgical service. We have also other objects which were not made for the site and imported later on, but that also gives testimony of the history of the circulation, even if we don't have any more precise information, like these servers or wearer, these kind of things. I put it for Julie. And more surprisingly, we find also these shields that could be of Indian origin, maybe dated by a stylistic comparison with the Indian paintings of the 11th or 13th century, but we don't have any other testimony of the relationship with India at that time, even if we know this relationship for later time. Some of these objects were found buried in pools or in trenches, and it also raised the questions of why are they there? Were they thrown away? Were they hidden? We don't have any idea of that, but it also gives some clues about phases of oblivion on the site. Some of these objects can be related to the monuments more precisely, like mobile wooden altars. As Marie-Laure told you, we have around 10 on the site with inscriptions naming King Lalibela himself, and this is a very exceptional set of objects comparing what we know for other churches all over the country. And as you can see on these altars, you have an inscription saying at the first person singular how the king himself dedicated the altar for one of the churches. It indicates the investment of the king himself at the beginning of the 13th century on the site and on the churches of the site, and it corresponds to a period in the history of the liturgy when the side rooms, before used for the preparation of the Eucharist, were transformed into secondary sanctuaries, and these altars were made at this time for these new sanctuaries. In one case, we have one altar dedicated to Gabriel, to the Archangel Gabriel, by Lalibela, and is still kept in the church of the same name. But we can see that it was for sure meant for the chapel designed in the northern part, in the northern rooms of the monuments, and for sure dedicated to Gabriel. So it also shows us that at that time, only a little part of the monument was a chapel, and not the whole monument was not a church at that time, and it was transformed as a church only later on. At that time also there was windows opened in the wall to for the chapel, and he cut a preliminary pillar that also show a previous use of the monuments. I'm showing you here three of these altars dated from the time of Lalibela, so at the beginning of the 14th century, and that's a good reminder that we cannot deduce from the different kind of ornamentation or the different levels of sophistication of the ornamentation. We cannot deduce from that that they can be dated from different periods, in case we were tempted to do this kind of research. At the same time, maybe we can find some vestiges of mural paintings in some churches. One of the churches is fully painted, but I prefer to show you only very little traces. And for the other, you will come and see us. So, from the style of the painting, as you can see, it will be very difficult to say something. But the script of the inscription indicates maybe it's also a paleography. It's not very precise in other case, but we can be sure that it will be let's say maybe around 13th or 14th century, and we can read the name of Muskel. There is a second word that we can be tempted also to read as Cobra, because it will give us the name of the wife of King Lalibela, Muskel Cobra, but I cannot say that the second word is Cobra. Unfortunately, it doesn't work. In the life of Saint Lalibela, Marie-Laure just explained that it was written in the 15th century. The writer described some gifts of Lalibela for the churches, and told that there was paintings in the church of the Bras Golgotha. Of course, this text of the 15th century is not describing the state of the place in the 13th century, two centuries before. Maybe it also didn't describe the state of the 15th century when he was writing, but at least it gives us an idea of what the writer would like to see there, and is talking so about the painting of the Bras Golgotha as being the most spectacular on the site. So in the translation of the life, it is side painting, but actually the same words can designate it also sculptures. Even sculptures in Ethiopia are very rare, and the one we have in Lalibela are quite also exceptional. We can see here one drawing of the inside of the Dr. Golgotha church, where we can find maybe, because what Marie-Laure didn't tell you, that of course it is very dark, but it's also forbidden woman, and it's also forbidden to layman. Layman can enter, but only in the first part of the place. So we have some pictures, but not of all of them, and we were not able to check some of the things by ourselves. So we have in this church seven standing sculptures in a bas-relief, and we have also a recumbent Christ that we know by archive pictures. It could be also tempting to deduce from the style of this recumbent Christ that it could be of a different period than the standing pictures, because the technology of the sculpture is not exactly the same. We have here the sculptures in two planes, two grounds, with the internal parts only drawn by incision and not with rounded modeling as the other figures in the church. It's quite similar with another sculpture on the side, but I'm not going to develop, to show you now the standing sculptures in the church. We have three of them on the northern wall, and you will see the different state of these sculptures comparing them to the sculpture on the southern wall, and we don't have definitive conclusions about that. It could either present state reflecting the degradation of the sculpture, the heterogeneous state of the rock, and maybe they can be only tried and not achieved. On the southern wall, you can see that much more carefully. Anyway, so we have three of them. And you can see that Syriac in the middle is also quite different. He's wearing a turban when the others have arrows. And he's in the middle of Syriac and George, we have a female figure painted on a pillar. And some scholars propose to see with this figure Saint Juliet, who is the mother of Syriac. And they were associated together in their martyrdom because they were supposed to die together when Syriac was a child. The sculpture of Syriac is much smaller than the other, and they said it's much smaller because it is a child, but I think that's quite difficult to see a child in this kind of figure. And I think it's more interesting to notice the turban that could indicate more surely a patriarch or a bishop, even if we don't know in Ethiopian history a bishop of that name, so it's more surely a writer. If it is really Syriac, it could be a writer, author of homilies translated and used in Ethiopian church. This turban also can be I'm just going to go back a little bit, because in Ethiopian painting, it's very rare to find human figures wearing turbans, and we can find some of them only in 16th century paintings, and in that case, every kind of figures can wear this kind of turbans. In one case, we have one saint of the Ethiopian church or an archangel. This painting is approximately dated of the middle of the 16th century. I'm not going in the detail, but it's not so strongly dated. We can compare it with the design of the sculptures, but I don't want to draw more conclusion about that. It could be archival and so on. I'm not saying that the sculptures in the Dragon Ball Park will be also dated from the secret factory, but that's all the information that we can have now. So I just want to gather them and also to say what we can really say from that. In the same church also, we can find other vestiges of paintings, and it would have been interesting also to think that Juliet was added in a second time to complement the figure of Cyriac, and in that case we can think that the painted program come later than the sculpted program, and we could have also deduced from that all the painting in the church could be later on, but unfortunately another time it doesn't work at well, and it doesn't give us any sequence. Even if we can if we can see that one of the doors on the right is cutting the painting and has been made, of course, later. I'm just going quickly on another part of the site, a little bit later on, in the Church of Beta Mercurius. The history of the libraries of the churches we made with Marie-Laure show some different periods of investment, some periods when the clerics in La Libola write a lot of books. We have some periods at the beginning of the 15th century, another one in the 15th century, and another important period of manuscript production in the end of the 17th and 18th century. But in Beta Mercurius, and for sure that church was not conceived as a church, but later assigned to the liturgical service. In the life of Saint Lalibola, it is mentioned as a church, so we can guess that at the time it was a church. We can find there a painted pillar, only one. It's quite difficult to see. I'm just showing you the upper register. From a stylistical point of view, we can say that it could be dated from the 16th century. We can wonder if all the whole church was painted or not. It was not so sure that it was completely painted. Here we can see some priest of heaven, and this kind of iconographic subject is usually organized in another way. Normally they are supposed to surround the representation of God the Father, and here they are facing each other, so that's also an anomaly that we cannot do. This is what we can see nowadays on the site, but in the 1916 there was some conservation work there, and the Italian workers removed mural paintings on canvas that was glued on the first one later on. And here they are removing the letter painting that we can see now, and this letter painting has been now put on the frame and displayed in another part of the church. More surely it is dated from the 18th century, and it goes together with another mural painting on canvas also. Now in the National Museum in Addis Ababa, and removed from the Lalibolas Church in the 1950s. But we don't have any indication on the place it was inside the church in Lalibola, and even considering the present map of the church, it's quite difficult to determine. What it could be maybe a little bit more interesting is that it corresponds to this period at the end of the 17th and first half of the 18th century, where there is a big new development on the site when the region became the center of the of an independent kingdom, and when the rulers there develop a new manuscript production. And we have some testimonies of that in text, when we have a priest in Lalibela wondering if he is going to honor Lalibela, is wondering if he's going to have some new churches excavated, or only if he's going to add only new mobile altars. And finally, he chose the second submission. So this is work still in progress, and we hope that we will continue the discussion with you, maybe in Lalibela one day. But thank you for all of your attention.